And then there's kind of, well, we got to get on with this. And there's a lot of education during this next stage, kind of when they're rebuilding the tire. And then just a shout out to Troy Marshall. You know, we had a lot of press, and I thought Troy's article was quite fair and honest. You know, basically saying, yeah, some holes went up, some went down, but it's a game changer for the industry. So another thing I think we learned was you can't do too much communication. So we tried, you know, I would say going into it, I said to our CEO, I said, I've never communicated this much about anything before. TV, BIF, convention, articles, talking points, everything. But I still had breeders call me and say, how was I totally blindsided by this? How did I not know this was coming? I don't know why you didn't know this was coming, because we tried to tell you every which way we could. So then after it's out, when people see how bulls change, there was a lot of communication. Dan and Kelly here, they do most of it, right? That's primarily who does that. It comes in a lot of different forms. A lot of it is that little black box there called telephone. And I don't know, you know, if it's in the future when my kids are the producers, because they will do anything else talking on telephone. But a lot of producers still like talking on telephone. So, a lot of phone time, and then it's just basically people just want to learn. They want to understand, you know, why these bulls change. They understand they change, and there's kind of acceptance to move along. And that's kind of a couple of months. Sharon's exactly right. A couple of months, you know, this thing, whole thing's going to blow over. And but really, today I think we have an evaluation system that's a lot better. You know, we run that every week, and we look at changers. Like we see bulls change. Then see a bull change, well, why did he change? And then you can look back and, well, he added genotype, he added project, he added data. And it just makes a lot more sense. It's a lot more stable, it's a lot more current. I think if I pass the bucket around and said, everyone put your cell phones in the bucket, you know, we're going to take away that technology, we're going to actually go back to the flip phone, you'd all say no. If you asked us, you know, we want to go, forget those things, we'll go back to what you used to do. What we're doing now is way better than what we were doing. So I'll talk about branding here in a minute, but people talk about single step. So, yeah, well, once you guys went to single step, this happened. Well, on July 7th, we did a lot of things. Yes, we implemented a new statistical method called single step, which Danielle Rango from Georgia is going to talk a lot about, and that's the software that we use. But we also changed the carcass model. So we identified that we weren't properly accounting for pre-selection in our model. So we basically made a more complete model. I showed that last year at that EIF. We updated all our heritability and genetic correlation estimates. We updated economic value. So there's a lot of things that will happen at once. And often when I deal with a breeder, like why does it change, it's not really because of single step, it's because of the new carcass model. So a little bit about branding. I distinctly remember being at a barbecue once, John Pollock was there, and said, the problem is us animal breeders are terrible at marketing. He goes, you know, here we have technology, EPDs, selection tools, change the world. He goes, and we call it a lump. You know, we're terrible at marketing, right? And so, but single step now is like brand. We hear producers talking about it all the time. They talk about now a single step, and this is single step. I don't know that they really, it's a statistical methodology and things, right? But it's now, it's brand name. And, just like certified eggs, beef, Amazon, Coca-Cola, something like that. I think we could probably do a better job of that ahead of time, giving something a name, giving something a brand, so they can recognize it right away. Single step's okay, but it's probably not that accurate, maybe not what we might have chosen as everything. So Dan showed this earlier today too, so but I've got a title, and that is you know, you can have a great, you can have a doesn't matter what your genetic methodology is, it's only as, your valuation is only as good as the data that you got behind. And so I just updated this for this talk, and it's interesting, so last time I talked in February, just to go through the weekly report of what the current count is and update it. You can see, geez, we had this much and this much and this much, which is great. So the one, the bottom line there is just this past week we surpassed 500,000 genotypes. And it's kind of been a milestone I've been looking forward to because that's that significant. And a million samples in the database or in the certain vaults. So has single step been accepted, right? As you know, obviously I told you about it, I had a picture of Rocky and it wasn't that bad. Because actually, breeders are road crash. I found anyways in dealing with them, you know, like obviously you just devalue some of their cattle, but they're incredibly fresh professional on the phone, which is nice. So when I first looked at Kane, when I first was considering coming to Angus, I remember Dan's email, he said, you know, we've got something like 250,000 animals genotype out. I thought, wow, that's a lot. But looking backwards, in 96 weeks, we've doubled that. And genotypes right now, since November, since the convention, have been coming in at just over 3,000 on average, 3,000 samples a week. So if breeders kind of threw their hands up and said, this DNA thing is all for naught, the single step thing is forget it, I'm not going to genotype anymore, or something like that, it hasn't shown up in the samples, right? If you look at that line, if anything, it's going up. We're getting more samples in now than we ever have. So I think we really have turned the corner. And I have Canadian Angus's logo down there, because as I said, with single step now, all the genotypes come in. So this increase in genotypes is also all Canadian data coming in. So that's a great combined database. So after kind of the 2 months passed, and you kind of settle in, okay, what's kind of new, or what's kind of some new things that we see coming through? This one stands out, you know. How can two flush mates be this different on ABDs? Right, we're predicting more difference now than we were before. If you got more accuracy, you can predict more difference. That's the bottom line. And how, you know, for a breeder, and so part of it is it's like a step back to basic genetics, right? It's back to understanding, okay, what causes variability. And it really all comes down to pedigree relationships. And I've got a picture here of 23-4. He is the biggest contributor to the Angus breed, and he contributes about 10% on average to every animal. So he has had a huge impact in the breed. But what we do in terms of genetic evaluation, whether it's genomic evaluation or even before genomics, we build this pedigree relationship box. And we call this the A matrix. And I think if I found anything really interesting as a grad student and things growing up as an animal breeder, I guess it's just the power of this A matrix. It's this relationship amongst all the animals that really makes a lot of work. It makes genetic evaluation work. And without genomics, we apply simple rules. Right? The simple rule is you inherit half your genetics from your mom and dad. And they inherit half of their genetics from their mom and dad, so you've got a quarter from each of the grandparents. And so this is just if we just had pedigree, this is what your genomic relation, this is what your relationship matrix would look like. But with genomics, we can say, well, actually, you didn't inherit a quarter from that grandparent. You inherited a different value. So let's put that in, we modify that relationship matrix, and that's what Daniela's software and technique does. So why does this happen and how significant is this? I've got a little cartoon to walk through, kind of reminding us about how chromosomes recombine and how we can inherit different amounts of DNA from each of our grandparents. So here's a sire, and he's got, for this chromosome, you know, he's got two pairs of chromosomes. The blue one he inherited from his sire, and the pink one he inherited from his dam. Now he's going to pass on one strand to the offspring here. And what's he going to pass on? Well, he's going to pass on the blue and the pink one. Well, he doesn't pass on either. He passes on a combination of both of them. And so he can pass on, for example, the bottom half that he got from sire, the top half he got from his dam, and we call that a recombination of A. got traced his calf. So the calf obviously has another chromosome that got from his father, and it's broken up too. But I just put it in the screen there for now. So you see there's half and half. But he'll make another calf. So think of these slush mates, right? So this sire produced, say, three embryos. The first embryo on that chromosome, he passed along something that looks like this. This one he passes on a chromosome that looks like this. So he's got, you know, it's all pink at the bottom. He got that from his dam. And then again, we do another one, we make a double recombination, something like this. And he passes that on. So how big a deal is this? What does it matter that on this chromosome you pass on, you know, the top half you got from the sire or the bottom half that you got from his sire? Does it make a big difference in the calf? So what I did to kind of give you an idea of real differences in Angus data is I took our top, there's 193 bulls. These are the bulls that have registered most calves with Angus recently. And I looked at chromosome 6. And why chromosome 6? Because that's my favorite chromosome. I thought, well, breeders would know a favorite bull or a favorite cow, I'd have a favorite chromosome. So mine just happens to be chromosome 6. And I took our formula, so in Danielle's software, we calculate the genomic breeding values, but we can also calculate a direct genomic value, which is just the SNPs on a chromosome multiplied by their effect all summed up. And we do that across the whole genome, all the SNPs and all the chromosomes, to get a direct genomic value, and that creates the genomic scores that you guys see. So I said, let's go for chromosome 6, and we'll rank those 193 sires on birth weight based just on the direct genomic value for chromosome 6. And I ranked them 1 to 193. Now, 1 would be the bull with the lowest birth weight, okay, because we like low birth weights, and 193 would be the bull with the actual highest birth weight, according to the chromosome 6 contribution. And I said, well, what if I rank those bulls if I just score the top half of chromosome 6? Or I just score the bottom half of chromosome 6? How much variability is there? And I'm just showing you here four different bulls. So the one bull, again, I don't show you any actual bulls' names. These are real bulls' names. These are, you know, they're the... If there's an Angus breeder here, he says he's an AI sire this year, he's on the list of 193. But I got a bull here, I call them all good. You know, if I rank him based on low birth weight for chromosome 6, he's number 1. And if I rank him on the top half, he's number 6. If I rank him on the bottom half, he's number 9. So he scores really, really good in his top half, his bottom half, and has all the whole chromosome. This other bull here, called top good, he ranks in the middle of the road for chromosome 6, 51 out of the 193. But he's number 7 if I rank him just on the top half of chromosome 6. He's at the other end of the spectrum if I rank him on the bottom half of chromosome 6. So why is that important? You know, if we go back to those chromosomes, you know, what half did you inherit from that sire? Did he pass on the top half or did he pass on the bottom half? If he passed on the top half, you're going to be really low birth weight for chromosome 6, that piece. If you pass on the other half, you're going to be at the other end of the scale. And then I found a bull that does the exact opposite, and the bull at the bottom, all bad, you know, he ranks pretty poorly for chromosome 6, top and bottom, and overall. So that's where this variability is coming from, right? There's very, it's due to recombination of what that animal's going to pass on. So I'm digging into this a little bit for breeders. You know, this idea that there's range in full SIBs, it's not new. This is Mendelian sampling, right? That's inheritance that we're talking about, and that's Mendel. So we look at variation. This is a distribution of weight in bull calves. Bull calves run 5,402 pounds in our data. Heritability 43%. A little bit over half of that is due to the environment. 43% of it's due to genetics, which gives us a distribution of EPDs that looks like this. They kind of go from minus 7 to +9 on the Angus scale. And if we look at the source of variation, what's causing variation amongst animals, my pie chart there is split into 2-3 categories. Half of it is what's the variation amongst the sires and dams that make up the calves. Half of that's due to variation amongst the sires, half of that's due to variation amongst the dams, and half of it's just due to Mendelian sampling. So half of the variation of the calves is all to do with just that random recombination of chromosomes and at the Neogen event a couple nights ago, they talked about that, just number-wise, how many recombination, how many different combinations there can be, and it's a huge, you know, quintile, a huge number of different possible combinations. So Mendelian sampling variation is really big. So then I looked at what we pull up here, 646 commercial ET calves. So these are calves, you know, registered Angus calves born from commercial dams. And they're interesting to look at because their records don't make it in the evaluation. It's just their parents and their genomics, that's it. We don't include their records in the evaluation. And there's 646 of those, and these are EPDs that went out the door in Angus. And I've basically centered them on 2 pounds of birth weight. So I've kind of made it look as though the parents were +2 and +2 for birth weight, so we can put them all on the same scale here. And what was kind of nice, you know, when you actually do this, you're kind of hoping for what it might look like. And it's a beautiful bell curve, right? We've got a nice distribution where half of them are above 2, half of them are below 2. But we've got, if you look on the right-hand side there, 4 animals that are actually over, they're 5 pounds birth weight. So what that's saying is, you know, somebody made it a +2 cow or +2 bull, and we sent EPDs out on the calf, which is +5, with no records. Just genomics would say he's actually +5 EPD. On the Angus scale, that's pretty big. So, Jimmy Good, would you, how many bulls do you use that are +5 birth weight? None. There you go. So, starting with branding now, but as a breeder, variation is actually your friend, right? And this, you know, I think we should have t-shirts for the breeders, you know, I love variation, because that's how you make progress. If we go back to this slide here, you might say, well, I'm not happy with genomics, you know, I had a +2 cow, or a +2 bull, and you're giving them a calf, I need to be a +5. Well, that whole point is, is it nice to know now that he's +5? You don't bring a lot of heifers and then find out that he's +5. Or actually giving us some prediction. So using the tool, you generate a lot of embryos, and you say, well, let's pick the ones that actually have got the beneficial EPDs. That's progress. So then we said, well, that's the EPD we put out the door. Is that real? Is that actually possible? Does that fit theory? And so what I did was that the answer is, it really is. So I basically did a little simulation using the parameters we have for birth weight, what's the genetic variation of birth weight, and these types of things go into that. And that's all estimated from the Angus data. And if we generate 1,000 progeny, where the mom was +2 and dad was +2, and we generate 1,000 embryos, in theory, some of those embryos could actually be +8. Right, that's the theoretical range in actual genetic value on the embryos. But we only said, well, we only put up +5 at the max. And why is that? Because our EPDs are not all, they're not 100% accurate on those embryos. Right, so they'll regress back to the mean a little bit. We don't predict the full value. In theory, the real genetic value is actually maybe even bigger than that. So theory and what we're putting up the door basically matches up. I'd like to just quickly go through one other kind of example. So we got these whole sibs, and they're different, and they're EPDs. And why is that? Well, it's all to do with that genomic relationship matrix, and how you're related to your ancestors. So two bulls here were different in birth weight EPD. Two full sibs, again, they're from commercially sibs, so birth weights aren't in the evaluation, it's just genomics. And we look at them there, and this is just the top side of the pedigree. And I showed you that because it's actually out of a fairly popular hole, Reserve 1111. There's nothing that's common secret there. There's tons of these scales out there. But if we look at it in theory, you know, we go back to say an animal in the ancestry there, Shearbrook Shoshone, and you know, what's his relationship to the calf? He's like, there should be 1/64 of the Shearbrook Shoshone in the calf. But then what's his genomics say? Is there more of him or less of him in that calf? And I kind of went through all the ancestors, and you'll see all the animals there and all the ancestors, and you'll see the earthquakes. So we've got some ancestors at the top, and we've got earthquakes plus five, and we've got ancestors at the bottom that have got earthquakes minus 1.6. It's a lot of difference. So did you inherit more of from the bowl? You just happened just due to chance, just due to that random event of recombination, did you actually inherit more DNA on average from Breedmaker than you did from ideal 3163 at the bottom? And then I looked at what we expect to get. So we expect 164s from Sherbrooke Shoshone, and then we looked at the difference in the full sibs. And the answer is basically the calf with a higher birth weight, he actually, on average, inherited more than we expect from the ancestors with high birth weight genetics, just due to chance. Right? So the genomic relationship information matches up with the EPDs that we're putting out. If I can point here. That's not the bottom. That's the bottom there. There we go. Yeah, I was just going to show kind of what that looks like. So, you know, here's an animal. You know that red bump? That's such an angle. I can't see it well, quite right. But you can see, for example, Rito 2100 there. We expect 1.5%, and we actually got 3.3%, which doesn't seem like a lot, but that's like twice as much. Right, that animal actually inherited twice as much from Reno 2100 than you would have expected, than compared to the other full sib. And those things just sum up across all those ancestors, and that contributes to that EBD difference. So what are the important points? July 7th really was an improvement. The carcass model was a big improvement. The system, the stability that runs week to week is a lot better. You have to pry it out of our hands, just switch back. It's all about, when we're trying to explain these differences, the full sibs has been, I think it's been a great experience in a way, because breeders see that and they recognize, well, that makes sense, right? This is the type of thing breeders have done for years. They say, well, I like that bull, but I don't like him back here in the pedigree, right? We're always concerned about those things. And now we actually account for that. Well, yeah, you got him back in the pedigree, but maybe he didn't contribute much to the offspring, or maybe he contributed more than average. And that's what breeders have been doing for years, and now you actually have a tool that accounts for it. The models are really important. You know, we can have a great method and great data, but if you don't put the right models in, the EPDs are sacrificed as well. And I think the tools that we got are going to allow breeders to make more rapid progress. Matt Barton was here from the Agen, talked about embryo genotyping and those things. So showing that variation among embryos, identifying the best ones, turning the generations over, the tools are going to make more progress. So turn it over to Mark.
Expected inheritance probabilities from each parent.
Yeah.
Is it possible now with the SNP profiles that you get to impute that even a little bit is to say this, what the actual inheritance was from the grandsire and the you know, great-grandsire, great-grandam, et cetera.
Right. So, yeah, so Troy's question was, going back to that slide about the relationship. So with the SNP data, can we actually do a better job of identifying how much you inherit from each of those parents? And so that's essentially what I did to generate those numbers. So in that case, all the ancestors I showed there were genotyped, and the calf is genotyped. And then Danielle at Georgia, you'll see here in a minute, provided us basically software to generate that genomic, what we call this genomic relationship matrix. So it generates what's the proportion of the genome that's in common between that calf and each of those ancestors.
So that could be made available. That could be like, I know you're generating your genomically enhanced EPDs with that.
Right. Yeah. So the question is that something that could be made available? I think it's not available at the moment. It's not a commercial tool really for me to turn it on. But I think digging into this, it's something could be made into a tool. So I think it's something breeders are going to be interested in. Even, let's say, if you're a breed that doesn't have a lot of genotypes, maybe you don't have genomically enhanced EPDs, but is that actually a way for you to get into the genomics game? Because you actually want to, breeders are keen to probably look at these things, right? So to be honest, for me to generate what I generated took me a long time because it's not a streamlined package, right? I generate the relationship matrix and it's a lot of fooling around to do all that. So there's no turnkey. I don't have some kind of curtain that I'm hiding from you that's ready to go. It's actually kind of in research mode.
Yeah, Don.
Given what you showed us on the half sibs and that some are more uniform, if you will, in the chromosome makeup, would there be a prediction and possibility of the reliability that an EPD is going to contribute half of its genetic makeup to one versus one that may do half good and show more variation in what it might contribute?
Yeah.
The common question is some cavities will throw a big one every now and then.
Yeah.
And is
predictive. Yes. So there's again, it's not a force to argue today, but that's the type of thing we could do. So on the dairy, one step ahead of us on this. And there's two sides to that. And actually, it might be counterintuitive to what you think. Because, you know, if you're a commercial breeder, that would be a form of implications. If you're an AI study that wants to generate the next outlier role, you actually want more variation, right? So the tool, the actual metric, could be potentially useful for both parties.
All right, let's thank Steve for a great presentation.